been doing an awful lot of thinking lately about how God's faithfulness throughout the years. I've been seeing how the Lord continues to move. Oh, it's just been wonderful. Over 45 years now. And I think back 10 years ago, it was, wow, it was like my life had just totally had the bottom drop out. And my wife Penny had died in February that year. In the month of June, my father had passed away. And then I get word on July the 8th that a man is on top of the Channel 24 tower. I said, oh Lord, we don't want to see anybody else die. God, we need a miracle. The emergency response crew could not figure out how to get this man off the tower. Well, as I was reviewing the miracle that God did, it just builds the faith of all of us. In fact, I want to share with you an interview that was done just a few weeks after that, how God miraculously got Matthew Gibson off the top of the Channel 24 tower in House Springs, Missouri. Marla's doing an interview with him, and she's asking various questions, and the man's describing how he got up on the tower. And it looked like a totally hopeless situation. All the time I'm praying, his mama's praying. I mean, people are praying. Emergency squad could not figure out how to get him off that tower. God divinely intervened. What a testimony. And I want to share with you this day that testimony.
And we've got an amazing testimony that I'm going to let Matthew tell you about what happened to him Sunday, July the 8th, against all odds. Hi, Matthew.
Hi, how are you doing?
Fine. Matthew, tell us how old you are, would you?
I'm 19.
Okay. What happened to you Saturday evening, July 7th, going into Sunday morning, July 8th? Would you like to just tell us the facts of what happened?
Yeah, I just want to let everyone know that it wasn't stupidity that drove me up here. It was literally something that I literally did not even remember climbing the tower. I actually woke up on top of the tower probably about 2 hours or so later. And if you're probably wondering how that happened, it's because I severely twisted my left ankle, and I asked a buddy of mine if he had any type of like pain medications to help me with it, and which he didn't, but one of his friends that he knew did. So we went to his house, and I ended up getting two pills, and they weren't pain pills. I don't know what they were actually. And the hospital did a bunch of blood work, urine samples, everything, and I couldn't really figure out exactly what it was, but they said it could have been an allergic reaction or something that drove me to, like, not remember anything.
About what time Saturday evening did that happen that you took what you thought were two pain pills?
About 11 or so, 11:30 at night.
Okay, what's the next thing, Matthew, that you remember?
I just literally remember pulling into this rocky road because I noticed I wasn't driving right and I did not want to wreck the company truck, so I pulled over into this road. And I really didn't even notice the tower being there.
You mean you were on your way home under the influence of the two pills?
Yes, exactly. And what was, I didn't want to wreck the truck, like I was saying. And so I took the keys out of the truck, and I pretty much don't remember much from there. Like, I literally woke up on top of the tower. Like, I don't really, literally don't know how I got up there. I mean, it was the scariest thing I've ever seen. But with a severely sprained ankle.
And this was still dark. It was still the wee hours of Saturday night into Sunday morning.
Yes. It was terrifying, but yet once I started praying to God, He started comforting me. It took about 30 minutes for me to actually stop hyperventilating because I was literally terrified. And pretty much just kept praying, God, please help me. Please help me, Lord. I mean, He already helped me climb up it. So.
What were you holding on to during that first half hour of hyperventilation and trying to get your thoughts together?
I was holding on to. There's like big bars that are like underneath me, the platform that I actually woke up on. I pretty much put my hands underneath the platform, like little bars, and was holding on to those the whole time. So.
At that point, it's been 30 minutes. You've been hyperventilating. You're trying to stabilize yourself. Is a plan coming to you? What's coming to you?
Well, I just started to think I need to get down from this tower. I need to do it pretty fast because it was definitely really windy and I was really scared. So. I just kept praying to God, please, Lord, don't let me die and just keep me safe. And so I tried to climb down a part of the tower, and there's literally no many, like, it's all X bars going up. There's no.
What did you do before you started to climb down that you told your mother and several of us?
I tried to climb down at first, and I actually slipped and almost fell. And then I went back up to the platform, and I stayed there another, like, probably 30 minutes or so, and I thought of another plan. I got to get somebody's attention. And I'm yelling down at the car because one of my buddies was still in the truck and I don't exactly know what he was doing. I couldn't even see him, so I actually haven't even talked to him this whole time. But So I kept yelling down to him and trying to get his attention. And when I realized he wasn't reacting to anything, I was actually thought of a really good idea. I guess God just gave me the idea to where I was at the platform. There's probably about a ladder that goes up another 20 feet or so, because I was about 940 feet up there on the platform. And the ladder goes up another 20 feet. So I climbed all the way up that to the actual big light bulb that's on the top. So it has a big plastic case over it. It hurt a lot climbing up there, but God helped me so I can get somebody's attention, and climbed up there, and I literally sat on top of the big plastic thing, held onto, like, there was light, four lightning rods surrounding it, held to the lightning rods, and then I started just praying and saying, God, please let somebody hear me, and I kept yelling, like, as loud as I could all over the place, and then I thought of a good idea to take off my shirt and maybe cover the light so it would, like, blink a different color, and so I did that. A long time, and it literally took about 45 minutes, and I seen somebody about a quarter mile away. I don't know how they heard me, but I kept hearing something. Oh, I couldn't understand it at all. Like, I couldn't hear it, but I looked over where I heard the echo, and I seen somebody literally standing there. I don't want to see him, but I seen the light blinking about a quarter mile away, and so they blinked it about three times or so, so I covered the light and uncovered it three times.
Beautiful. Kind of a simplified Morse code.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so that was your first human contact while you were up there at risk, so to speak.
Wow, was Matthew's back ever up against the wall? Situation seemed absolutely hopeless. Ending up, can you imagine, on top of a tower, waking up, and you look down? I mean, we're talking about, you could see the arch from that tower way out in Howell Springs. You know, you're looking at hundreds and hundreds of feet below you. There's no ladder there. So how does he get down? How does he get out of that particular situation? He's calling on God. He's praying. It seems almost hopeless, but it's his faith that sustained him. It's what kept him going, where he just didn't give up.
What did you do next?
I knew that somebody was probably going to come after that. And once I started hearing the police sirens, I climbed back down to the platform and just waited there thinking they were going to be able to help me.
How far down was that? Back down 40.
Yeah, back down 20 feet to the platform that I was at.
Now comes the precarious part, because you haven't told any of our listeners yet how you got down. All right, Matthew, you're building to a climax here, and you've lived it. Are you able to tell us the rest?
Yeah, I am. I was up there for about five more hours. I was already up there for 2 hours or so without anybody knowing that. And the police department was probably there for about 5 or 6 hours, I'm guessing. And there was probably at least 37 or 40 different emergency vehicles. Literally.
Do you mean all of those people assembled and were present before you began your actual descent down?
Yeah.
And they were there for quite some time?
Yeah.
Was it because it was taking you a while to get courage and a plan, or what?
Well, the reason why I actually tried going down the cable itself, which I'll explain exactly how that happened, is because I couldn't communicate with them at all, and they couldn't communicate with me either. They were using a loudspeaker either. Even, and I couldn't even understand that. So I actually tried to climb down again, thinking my ankle might be able to hold myself. Like, I knew I wouldn't fall, because God literally comforted me. Like, I knew I wasn't going to die. That's all there was to it. That didn't even cross my mind. There was no question about that. But I pretty much used all my arm strength to try to climb down the X bars, and I almost slipped again, and I just couldn't support myself on my left ankle. So what I did was went back up there onto the platform, and I just waited there a little bit and just kept asking God, please just direct me how to get down here, because there was no helicopters, nothing. There was literally...
I understand a helicopter attempted to intercept the situation, but they could not get low enough to reach you. Is that right?
No, that's not correct. There was no helicopter, period, until I actually tried to go down the actual cable.
Until you tried to go down. Oh, okay. All right. Well, you just tell it.
So I thought this would be a really good idea. I thought I could easily climb down, or actually go down. I'm planning on sliding down at all. That was not the initial plan. But what I did was it's about 3 feet below where I was at on the other side of the platform. So I managed to get myself through these cables that are like in between there. And so I got through those, and I shook the cable a whole bunch, and it wouldn't move at all. It's literally like about 2 inches thick or so. I thought that I could literally slide down it, like picture the cable going over me from the front angle, like my stomach being on the cable. I put my legs like in a V, if you would say.
Like a fireman would go down.
Like a pole, but say it's on a 45-degree angle more, because it was sloped, and it wasn't straight down, of course. That would have been really hard. But so I actually went down it a good 100 feet perfectly. on the top of it, not flipping over or nothing. And once I got about 100 feet down is when the cable started to sway back and forth a ton. And I did not think that was going to happen, or I would not have tried it.
What was in your mouth? Is it true you had something in your mouth before you began this?
Actually, that was false. Like, actually, it was a picture of Jesus that I had in my wallet, and I took it out before I climbed down, and I actually had it in my pocket. And I have gym shorts on, but that's what happened, though. I didn't have it in my mouth, though. I was constantly praying the whole time, saying, God, protect me, of course. And so when I actually flipped upside down, I literally flipped upside down when it swayed back and forth. And I probably hang there just by my hands, which I did for about 2 seconds or so, and I immediately wrapped my legs around it and just held on to it as hard as I could. I probably stayed in that same spot for about 10 minutes, and I just kept praying, God, please do not let me die. And I was thinking about my mom and my little brothers and my sister. I mean, I was terrified. But, I mean, I was scared, but like I said, I was not scared that I was going to die. It's like God was comforting me, letting me know he's going to let me get me down there.
That's a real living testimony to have God speak to your heart and give you some assurance in a terrifying crisis like that. How did the ending result?
Well, when I was still hanging there, what I really knew that I had to get down quick, and I actually hanged there a little bit longer, like upside down. My hands actually got so tired that I literally had to start holding on with my other sides of my elbows. Like the opposite side of your elbow, whatever this is called.
Is that why you have such heavy bandages on both arms?
No, that's not the whole reason why, but that's kind of why I got them scraped up a little bit at first. And when I held on like this, I still hanged up there for about at least 10 or 15 minutes. And I realized there was a black helicopter came and landed in the field beside me, so that made me hold on there longer. Instead of trying to climb down more, I thought maybe that might have been a rescue helicopter, but I haven't seen one the whole day. And so what I did was held on as long as I could, thinking they're going to send some people in the helicopter and fly up there and drop down and save me. So I just kept praying and praying, God, just please give me the strength to hold on, which he definitely gave me the strength. And I thank God for that every day, and there's nobody else that I can thank. I give him 100%. Like, literally, I wouldn't have been alive if it wasn't God.
That's beautiful, Matthew, and I hope that inspires faith and confidence in God and a whole lot of people who are listening, so that if and when you have a crisis moment like Matthew Gibson had a couple of Sundays ago, that you can know who to call on and what name to call on and who to trust to help you in your crisis.
And then also, when I actually was hanging there, the helicopter lifted off and like hovered above me a good, like, I'm saying a good 300 feet above me. Like, they weren't that close because they didn't want to like make me blow off, of course, but by then, I realized it was not a rescue helicopter. It was just a police helicopter, and that's what my mom said earlier. And so then I knew that I had to get down. I had to get down quick. So literally, this cable was probably about, since the tower was 980 feet tall, the cable was around 2,000-something feet long. Probably about 2,800 feet, I'm guessing, somewhere around there. Long, because it's angled. And all these wires, like, there's probably about, I'm on the very top one. They all intercept into one. Like, at the very bottom, they all intercept into, like, these big hooks that hold it into the ground. There's, like, all cables below me, so there's no way I could drop, because, I mean, if I dropped anyway, I would die either way. But, actually, Satan really did try to convince me. I knew it wasn't from God. He tried to convince me, if you let go now, you're going straight to heaven, which I knew that was not from God whatsoever, because my God would not do that, especially if you're praying for him to, if you're praying to stay alive, you know what I mean?
It sounds a little bit like the temptation of Jesus in the wilderness, doesn't it?
Yeah, like Satan will try to convince you that, like, he'll put thoughts in your head saying, oh, if you let go, you'll be fine. You can maybe land in the trees and survive. No, that wasn't for my God. I know that. I know my God was keeping me alive, and that's why I'm alive.
So are you saying that in those critical moments, you were able to distinguish the voice and leading of God from the voice and leading of your spiritual enemy?
Yes, that's definitely a fact. Yeah, he was trying hard. Satan was definitely trying for me to let go. I guess, I don't know, he just wanted me to die, I guess.
How can teen guys or parents or senior citizens, girls, anybody listening to this, 8-year-olds, how would you counsel them, or how would you say that you knew which voice to follow?
Oh, you'll always know the voice. If you pray to God, he'll let you know. Like, he'll comfort you whenever he's talking to you. But if you hear anything else that's not comforting, it's not from God. And that's all there is to it. And literally.
Is there false comfort that he was trying to bring you, though, the enemy?
I wouldn't really say false comfort. It was more like just thoughts that he would put in your head. Those were more thoughts that kind of like, you know how, it's kind of like having a bird land in your hair. You don't want him to build a nest. So that's what Satan was trying to do, trying to build a nest in my hair to let me, convince me to let go. You kind of see what I'm saying? And so from then on, I knew I had to get down. Like I said, that helicopter wasn't a rescue helicopter. So if you don't know what a zip line is, a zip line is actually a thing you would hold on to and ride a cable down with your hands. I pretty much did that with this arm. I made it into a zip line, pretty much. I mean, that's the only way I could get down. So what I did is I actually literally took my arms after I was already wrapped, and I took this hand, grabbed it. The cable goes to right here, and I wrapped my legs around as much as I could, and tried to go down slow, but I couldn't. And I just literally flew down that cable from about 100 feet off the top. So I was probably about 800 feet above the ground, but yet cable probably went still a good 2,000 feet or more down.
I wonder how many miles per hour you'd estimate you were going at that point.
I'm guessing like 45 or 50 miles an hour, like literally. I mean, the ground came up so fast that I just closed my eyes and just kept praying, God, please keep me alive.
You had to rely on this arm because you had a compromised ankle, right?
Yeah. Well, actually, at that point, I literally wasn't. I just used the under parts of my, like literally I had these parts of my legs on top.
Show them your bandages and all the places you've got bandages.
All over. I actually had to get a very intense plastic surgery from they call it skin grafts. That's what I got. And this arm actually was in like a splint because I wasn't able to bend it because I had to repair it. When I was actually sliding down, my skin was literally smoking. There was white smoke literally coming off of my skin. And tell you the truth, I really didn't feel it. I mean, I guess God just took the pain from me. I mean, because if I probably would have felt that pain, I probably would have let go. So.
Thank God.
Yeah.
It looks like God still does big things, doesn't it?
It's definitely a fact, and I'm living proof of that. And so actually when I'm sliding down, coming straight towards all those intersecting cables like I told you earlier, and what happened was I just pretty much closed my eyes, and my gym shorts I had on were kind of like these, but they're black, and I had a t-shirt on. And I'm flying down this cable, so I'm seeing the bottom coming up quick. So I'm thinking, that's going to hurt. But so I just closed my eyes and kept praying to God. And next thing you know, boom, I stopped.
So he figures out he's going to start coming down that tower. I mean, he's riding down a guy wire. What about when he hits the bottom? What saved him? What kept him? I mean, there's another miracle still in store with this. This guy's buzzing down this guy wire, and you can just imagine the worst that suddenly get to the end of the concrete embankment and just like wipe out. But the miracles continued. And maybe at this moment you feel like your back's up against the wall, you're dangling there, and just well, what's the use of trying? You just want to give up. Don't give up. Give it to God. That's how Matthew made it through this ordeal. And I just want to encourage you to exercise your faith at this particular time and watch the Lord do exceedingly beyond what you can even ask or think. Let's go back to that interview. It was done almost 10 years ago in July of 2007. But the miracles continue. The miracles continue. Here he was, if you just tuned in, Matthew finds himself on the top of the KNLC Channel 24 tower in House Springs, Missouri. He's trying to figure out how to get down. All the rescue squads could not get him down. The efforts of man were not able to help intervene at this particular time. And so he's starting to come down the guy wires. Well, what kept him from whizzing down and actually, when he hits that concrete embankment at the base, actually just dying? Another miracle took place.
And my pants literally got caught on this little bitty thing that happened to be welded about 8 feet or so above the actual finish point. And I actually felt my back rub the back of a cable just for a split second, and then I stopped. Right as soon as my back touched, I stopped. And I actually didn't even get injured one bit at all when I stopped. And I instantly started yelling, thank you, Jesus. And I was just saying, God, thank you so much. And I just kept yelling it out. Like, they literally heard me, the rescue crew heard me yelling, help me, Jesus, when I was actually sliding down. And he definitely helped me.
Thank you very much for sharing this so openly. And as I'm sitting here and you're finishing your story, I'm feeling this mother's heart who turned to Christ in her, was it in your youth?
Yes.
Who turned to Christ and had some of the Word of God sown in her heart as a youngster, a young person, and eventually made some choices in life to grow in the Word and grow in faith and grow in her personal relationship with Christ. As I'm sitting here, I'm feeling your heart heaving sighs of relief and gratitude. Can you give us a bit of a testimony as a mom to why prayer counts and why prayer is heard by God?
My son Matthew is living proof, and I'm just, you can get emotional because you're human. You can cry when you see your son. God gave you that emotion as a mother to be able to raise your children, to be sensitive, to be able to cry when they cry. But God gave you a spirit. The spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwells in you. And that is the power that rises up inside a mother. And I can tell every mother that is out there listening right now, if you don't know the Lord, if you do know the Lord, get those scriptures. If your children are near the Lord, if they're not, pray those scriptures over your children. God watches his word to perform it. It never returns unto him void. And my son is living proof. He is living proof. And I just, what else can you say? But God, thank you. Thank you, Jesus. What can I do for you, Lord, now? What can I do for you? He spared my son's life. I know that there's a calling on his life. He wants to join the Navy. Maybe he can be a minister in the Navy. Maybe he can do something. But I know he has a calling on his life for God. I think we all do. Let's ask Matthew.
Correct. This is good. This is so good. And I know that one of the scriptures you were sharing was Isaiah 54, because I have prayed it for my grown son as he was coming up in his youth. And so you touched me when you referred to that, and it rang a real clear bell. Matthew's chiming in here. His mother's talking about callings, possible giftings and callings, a vocation from God. Matthew, what do you sense? Do you sense something on the horizon of a calling, a place for you in life from God after this?
I'm pretty sure I do got a calling on my life, but I'm not exactly for sure what it is yet, but I know God will show me what it is eventually, and I'm just trusting God to show me that. And I do want to say one thing. I just want to say thank you, Mom, for always praying for me like you always do. Every time I used to ride my bike, every time, anything, always pray for me. And if it wasn't for Mom teaching me about God, I would have never known to pray to God. And I probably would not have been alive right now. So if it wasn't for God, I give him 100% glory for it. I mean, he saved my life, and that's all there is to it.
100% glory.
Well, we want to thank God, the three of us and all of you listening. I'm sure there's many people out there who are thanking God right now by this moving testimony from two people who love each other and have learned to love God, maybe more. And so we're very, very thankful that we could report this to you, that we could share some good news and some good faith testimonies of things of very recent origin that have happened in this community. And we want to encourage every mother and every dad out there. If you know the Lord, trust him, lean heavy into him.
Wow, when it seems like all the routes are closed, God always makes a way. Out of what appears like total death, life can spring forth. That's what faith is all about. And hope you're inspired by this interview that was done almost 10 years ago with Matthew Gibson, and how the Lord miraculously got him off the Channel 24 tower. Maybe not on the Channel 24 tower, but you're on to some stuff that you need help. I find myself in that situation. Well, I got to believe that in the midst of what could be absolute hopeless situations, death itself, God can even allow life to spring forth. With God, all things are possible. What we need today is faith. There's so many situations, in spite of what the secular humanistic society says, that will not deliver us. And so I pray that this will be a day of faith for you as you turn loose right now and turn it over to God and dare to believe. Watch him bring forth life in the midst of the hopeless situations. Watch him do exceedingly beyond what you can even ask or think. That's the thought I want to share with you this day. Turn loose your faith and watch God move in a great and mighty way.